thanks for the invitation. this is, that's a joint, it's based on joint work with Octav Cornea. And so I was told that I should also try to go over more of the definitions and the motivation for the subject. So I'll try to combine both things. So the main object of study here are Lagrangian cobordisms in Lefschetz fibrations. So I should probably explain what do I mean by a Lefschetz fibration. So there are many nuances in different definitions, but the one I will adopt here is, so a Lefschetz fibration is, first of all, has a total space E, and it comes with a map to the complex plane, in my case. And this thing is endowed with plenty of structures. There is a symplectic structure on E. There is an almost complex structure on E, and by little I, I will denote the complex structure of the plane. And I'm going to assume that pi is holomorphic with respect to these structures. Of course, these j's are compatible with this omega. And there are isolated critical points. Isolated critical points. And they are all ordinary double points. So they are ODPs. So this means that this J is integrable near the singularities, and near each singularity you can write, you can find a holomorphic chart making pi really look like a holomorphic Morse function. Okay? And these are called ordinary double points. And I'm going to put an additional assumption, which is less traditional. And this one is called tame. So E is tame outside, outside of an open set U. So the open set I'm going to consider is basically something like that. That's U. That's in the plane. So I call E tame outside of U if you can trivialize everything outside of U. So the assumption is that E restricted to the complement of U, viewed as a symplectic manifold, is really isomorphic to a product of C minus U times a symplectic manifold denoted M. And this is endowed with a split symplectic structure. So it's going to be a constant times the standard symplectic structure of the plane, direct sum with some symplectic structure on M. Okay? And C is positive, of course. And M will be called the generic fiber. M is the generic fiber. Okay, so this looks like a very strong condition. However, every Lefschetz fibration can be adjusted to be like that. So every Lefschetz fibration you can, I don't want to go into the precise details, but every Lefschetz fibration you can keep it the way it was in some U like this, and at infinity change the structure such that it will look like this.
U is allowed to go off to infinity?
It should, actually. It should. It's a U-shaped. It should. Yeah, exactly.
It's by the definition of Lefschetz vibrations.
Yeah.
Do you require that away from the singular points, all you have sort of a topological vibration?
Yeah. Well, I didn't list all the properties, but yeah, it's supposed to be a submersion outside.
No, but submersion doesn't, I mean, can I take out a point of some arbitrary fiber, or is that not allowed?
It should be proper. No, I mean, there are many conditions here that I'm not going into, and What? Yeah.
So you're assuming that M is compact, then?
I assume that M is compact. However, I'm allowed to assume that M is convex at infinity too. But then I need to assume that at infinity, the whole thing without throwing U is trivializable. So yeah, I mean, I could spend half an hour only on the precise definitions, but somehow the message I want to convey is independent of those things. Anyway, so it's possible always to pass to this setting. And another important thing about these fibrations is that they come together with a connection. So there's a connection. And the connection is just, well, the horizontal distribution will always be, you know, the omega, omega orthogonal complement to the fiber. The connection doesn't exist everywhere. It exists only away from the critical points. Right? So it exists connection on E minus the critical points of pi. And this means you can do parallel transport.
Are you saying this is part of the data or something that exists?
No, omega induces it.
Ah, okay.
So you get parallel transport. So once again, omega, you take the fibers, they are symplectic, and you take the omega, capital omega orthogonal complement, and this gives you something two-dimensional that projects isomorphically to the base. Okay, so why do I fuss about tame? So I want a very convenient way to identify the fibers away from the U shape. And because of this trivialization that I'm going to fix, the connection is trivial there, and therefore the parallel transport in the complement of U is just trivial. I mean, it's the identity. And so this is very convenient for these things. Another object that exists here are thimbles. And vanishing cycles, vanishing spheres. So again, I'm going to do this not very rigorously and fast. So basically, if you take a critical point, a critical value, z, that's a critical z0 maybe, a critical value, and you take a path emanating from it, gamma, so all these structures together give you a submanifold, T gamma, T for thimble. And so this is thimble along gamma. And this thimble has the following properties. So T gamma is a Lagrangian submanifold of E omega, Lagrangian. What else? It is invariant. T gamma is invariant under parallel transport. Of course, parallel transport along gamma. Another thing, so how does it look actually? It is like this. So here's our gamma. So it looks basically like this. So over every point in gamma, you get a sphere inside the fiber over that point, except of over the point over z0, where you get a point. So altogether, this thing looks like a copy of a disk, a Lagrangian disk, Lagrangian inside the total space. And these spheres here are called the vanishing spheres because they just go and shrink and shrink and vanish. So these are called the vanishing spheres. So maybe I should write it for every z in gamma, which is not z0, T gamma intersecting the fiber over z is a sphere, Lagrangian sphere in EZ. and T gamma intersection E z zero is just 1 point. Okay, now it's not totally obvious how to construct this, but there are canonical constructions how to do it. And one way, for example, is one, not the most elegant way, is to take a local model, write the holomorphic Morse function, adjust the symplectic structure to be compatible to it and construct it locally and then move it by parallel transport. There are more elegant proofs, more elegant constructions for the thimbles. And again, this will take too much time to go into. Another thing that will play a role here.
Is thimble supposed to be unique or is it a choice?
Well, once you specify gamma, once you specify gamma, it becomes unique.
Like literally unique, I can't somehow take a slightly bigger sphere. Like, as a set, it's a unique thing.
Yes. Okay. Yes. But
one of these Lagrangian spheres, sort of in the fiber.
What?
Kind of in each fiber, there's only one of these Lagrangian spheres.
Yes, only one. Yeah, and then it goes and shrinks. Okay. Right. Okay. Well, I mean, what makes it unique is the fact that it's invariant under the parallel transport. If I drop that.
I mean, how to say, if I change the sphere a little bit in the fiber, then the fact that it's invariant under parallel transport is not telling you anything.
No. But then it will not necessarily converge to. Okay. Well, now the most important. Well, another important thing is the Dehn-twists. Dehn-twists. The Dehn-twist. So what is the Dehn-twist? That's a general thing. It has a priori nothing to do with Lefschetz fibrations. So you have a symplectic manifold, x omega. And you have a sphere inside it. But the sphere should be, if you want to be very precise, should be really parameterized by a model sphere. So it's really a map from Sn to x. And f is a Lagrangian embedding. So you have a Lagrangian sphere, Lagrangian embedding, right? Then these things induce in a basically canonical way an automorphism, a symplectic automorphism called tau. Let's write here L to be the image of Sn. And of course, L doesn't know how it was parameterized, so there's an abuse of notation here, but I will still write tau L. So tau L is a map from X to X, and that's a symplectic automorphism. and it is supported near L. Supported near L. And how do you basically construct it? So what you do is, well, you know, L comes always with a little, it's called Weinstein model neighborhood inside X. So a little neighborhood of L looks like the cotangent bundle of a sphere inside X. So if we are talking about compactly supported, so near L, so we can construct it there and install it inside the manifold. So we are going to look now at the geodesic flow from the unit disk cotangent bundle of Sn minus the zero section to itself, like this. And this is what I will call the normalized geodesic flow. So what do I mean normalized? I mean that the length, only the direction of the vector matters. The length doesn't matter, okay? And therefore, on the zero section, you don't get it. So actually, this is Hamiltonian. If you take the Hamiltonian function h of qp to be p square with a norm induced by the round metric, you get exactly this map. And what is kind of important what is kind of important here is that psi at time pi, and that's very special for the sphere, extends to the zero section. To the zero section, and becomes on the zero section exactly the antipodal map on zero section is antipodal map like this. And now basically you want to exploit this special symmetry of the sphere and extend everything. So you want to start on the zero section with antipodal map and go up the fibers, apply this normalized geodesic flow, but with slower and slower speed until you get to speed zero. So you need basically to choose a cutoff function that starts, say, with half here, and here it becomes, yeah, rho of s, I will call it, and here it becomes zero, and define something like that. Tau of x would be basically psi of 2 pi rho of absolute value of x, something like that. No square, otherwise it will exist everywhere, of course. No square. Thank you. Okay, that's the Dehn-twist, and it was kind of played a huge role in simplex topology. It was, it generalizes, it was discovered by, I don't know, by Seidel probably, but probably was known to Arnold in ancient times already. And it generalizes the classically two-dimensional Dehn-twist probably invented by Dehn. Well, according to Arnold, it might not always be the case. But anyway, I want to explain that the Dehn-twist actually has to do a lot with the monodromy of Lefschetz fibration. But before I really go into this, suppose I have a Lefschetz fibration with one critical point, and it is tame away of this u. And so this means that away from u, I can identify all fibers. And I'm taking here a Lagrangian k. So Lagrangian k in the fiber. And I'm moving it by parallel transport like this. So what I'm going to get here is exactly tau s of k, where s is the vanishing sphere of this singularity. If you have only one critical point, it's kind of well-defined, up to isotopy, okay, in M. Okay, so that's kind of for intuition. Okay, so now we can continue and get to Lagrangian cobordisms. So what are Lagrangian cobordisms? Lagrangian cobordisms.
Can I ask a question about this? Yeah. Suppose I have specified abstractly the fiber, and I choose a bunch of Lagrangian spheres in it, arbitrarily. Can you always make some Lefschetz vibration so that those are the vanishing cycles?
Well, if you fix one, you can always make it.
Okay.
But if you fix a bunch, I think it might become a bit delicate. But if you fix just one, so that's a kind of well-known fact which is exploited. I will exploit it too, that if you have a manifold with a Lagrangian sphere, you can always build a Lefschetz fibration having this manifold as a fiber, and this Lagrangian sphere is the vanishing sphere of some path.
So the only data actually in that case is just this thing, this map, not from the thing itself.
Yeah, yeah, you basically need to take the mapping torus of that and kind of fill it in with something. Yes. That's a construction. Okay, so Lagrangian cobordisms. So what are these? So we fix a tame Lefschetz fibration. Tame. By the way, I want to insist, I'm going to allow also Lefschetz fibrations without singularities. just products. So E equals M times C times M is allowed. So that's already good, and I want to include this. So what is a Lagrangian cobordism? So a Lagrangian null, and I'm not going to write null each time, null cobordism in E is, first of all, a Lagrangian submanifold in E is a Lagrangian submanifold. A V in E, like this, that sits in a like a cobordism inside E, yeah, such that this also has three. No, this doesn't have three. No. So I need to move here. Okay, so there's a discontinuity here. But so what happens with V? So first of all. When you restrict the projection to V, so that's a map from V to C, like this, and I will identify C with R2 many times in an obvious way, that's proper. That's proper, and there exists a huge real number, R, for which the following holds. When you take the inverse image of minus infinity, say minus R times R, so that's a subset of R2, then this looks very nicely. This looks like a union of rays. I don't know, R of them, say. So these are rays, LQ, multiplied by Lagrangians in the fiber with LQ in M Lagrangian. And let me explain, let me make a picture. And yeah, LJ in R2 are rays. So here's the picture. So here is the coordinate y equals 0, say. And here is x equals minus r. So let's look how the projection of the cobordism V looks like. So you're going to get something which has no structure, some set. But from this set, you're going to get some things that look like this. This is called ray L1, ray L2, until ray LR. So basically, V looks as follows. It is some Lagrangian submanifold inside E. And at infinity, or at minus infinity, it is completely cylindrical. So it looks like a ray, horizontal ray, times a Lagrangian submanifold, capital L1, a ray L2 times a Lagrangian submanifold L2 until LR times LR. Okay, that's the way it looks. And here is my, everything is tame, so here is my subset U, and you can do this. You can make the definitions without the tame condition. There's no problem. You just need to insist that these things are, invariant under parallel transport. But then, of course, you get into a lot of bookkeeping. Where do the Lagrangians capital L1 until capital LR live, right? They live in different fibers, and you need to identify the fibers, etc. This is why the tame condition is very convenient.
You're assuming somehow that nothing projects onto the far right?
Nothing.
Yes, so I don't think that follows.
No, it's not the full definition. You need also to assume that it's proper, I mean, I wrote proper map, but you also need to assume that nothing goes to infinity in this direction. So you need to also to project on the x-axis and assume that's proper, and here there's nothing. Yeah, yeah, there are many. But again, the definitions become long and...
But just to understand, the thing that occupies this void and those two voids is the definition.
Yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's a definition. Yeah, a definition, not full one, but right. Okay, so.
But you say it was a null cobordism. That's the
concept. Yeah, null cobordism. Right. Yeah, yeah. This is why I call it null cobordism. Yeah. Ah, now I need the hook. Right. Okay. Maybe. Exactly because. Well, you could say that the Lagrangians sitting here together, you know, it's null cobordant. There's a manifold bounding them. So also, it's not really a cobordism. You need to chop it here to get a cobordism in the classical sense. But this cylindricity at infinity is very convenient. Now, of course, I'm going to do some Floer theory, so I need to restrict to the type of Lagrangians I'm playing with. So without, you know, I think your workshop is in many ways dedicated to issues. The summer school is dedicated to issues coming up with what kind of problems you get when you do holomorphic curves with under different settings. I'm going to adopt the most conservative setting, so class of Lagrangians. And this is only for the analysis to work. I think that from the algebraic point of view, it's not so important. So I'm going to assume that they are either monotone or exact. So exact is already interesting. And they are compact.
What is the word monotone?
Right, so monotone, so again, without going into very long definitions, you see, when you have a Lagrangian submanifold, you have like a relative churn class called the Maslow index, which, you know, when you take a two-dimensional topological disk with boundary on the Lagrangian, it measures somehow the complexity of the Lagrangian sub-bundle inside the symplectic bundle, you know, how it rotates, and this measures it. Okay, that's the Maslow index. But you have another class. The other class is the symplectic area class. Monotone means that these two classes are well correlated. If one is positive, then the other is positive, and vice versa. You can think of it like the symplectic analog of Fano. Right? So this means in particular that if you have a holomorphic disk, then it has positive area, it will also have positive Maslow. And this Maslow index appears as when you calculate the dimension of spaces of holomorphic disks, and therefore you want these dimensions to be positive. And from here on, you go into the topic that you are exploring in this summer school. Right. And we will work with over the Novikov ring. Novikov ring, the full Novikov ring. And now we need to go into Fukaya categories. And once again, that's a vast topic, but so I cannot give full definitions. But we're going to play the following game. So we fix a tame Lefschetz vibration, tame, outside of a subset U. And I'm going to assume that the closure of U is in the upper half plane, so for convenience. And now there are two Fukaya categories that come that appear here. One of them is the fiber. So the fiber has a Fukaya category. So you know, you take all Lagrangian submanifolds of your class, and these together form an A-infinity category called the Fukaya category. So that's A-infinity category. And from it, you can define a so-called derived Fukaya category, which is already a honest-to-go category. So this is a linear triangulated category, which rectifies the problems that the original Donaldson category had, basically the fact that it was not triangulated. And similarly, but less classically, E itself gives you a Fukaya category of E, and also a derived Fukaya of E. So here, one should say something. So what are the objects here? Objects. So the objects here are, I mean, the way I define it, are really the null cobordisms. Null cobordisms in E. Not just all Lagrangians. And I'm going to really assume that they all lie above in the upper half plane with pi of v inside the upper half plane. That's again a matter of convenience, nothing else. Okay? So you want to make a Floer theory with such Lagrangians. And this already gives you some kind of problems. This already gives problems. The problem is that, you know, in Floer theory, you need the Lagrangians to make the Lagrangians intersect transversely before you start counting or make some Hamiltonian perturbations and so on. You can do it here also, but just look what's going on. That's one cobordism. Then you have another one. And it could be that at infinity, the rays just coincide. Or the rays coincide, okay, it could be that in the fiber you get an intersection point, and this intersection point gets multiplied by the ray. So if you want to make them transversely intersecting, you need to apply a perturbation which is not compactly supported. Okay? And this gives analytic problems. But before you get the analytic problems, you have another problem, is that the space of admissible perturbations, admissible for the analysis, is actually disconnected. And if you perturb in one direction and in a different direction, you get different results. So what is actually the Floer complex of, say, V and W? So here's one, here's V with the rays here. And here is W. I always project them and visualize them like that, but so here's W, say, and here's another one, like this. So what are you going to do with this pair? So you're going to perturb. You're going to perturb, say, W in such a way that now they look like this. I'll do it here. It may be better. So that's V, left unchanged. And here's W, epsilon perturbed. So I'm going to do the perturbation that it looks like this. So, and the rest is as before. If you need to perturb in the compact part, go ahead and do it. That's not a problem. here comes the essential perturbation. So you need to decide the second Lagrangian, where you perturb it, to be cylindrical below or cylindrical above. And if you do it in one way or the other, you get different results. So we are going to do it below. And the choice is, this choice has a reason. You want CF of V, V to be unital, and that's going to...
You have a whole, real line of choices.
Yes.
You could take fully wrapped, or is it not?
No, so that's an important remark. This is not wrapped.
Exactly.
Very non-wrapped.
Yeah, it's like infinitesimally wrapped or whatever.
I don't know what this means, but you see, I create just one point here. Wrapped means that you, right? Also, I'm not in a wrapped situation, so at infinity, I don't have a convexity. It's more flat at infinity. It's really different structure. Anyway, this is what I do. I forgot to say one thing about the null cobordisms. Of course, if you want to go into categorical language, it's convenient to make the ends hang on specified y-coordinates. And I forgot to mention that. So the null cobordisms I'm considering are like this, that ray L1 is hanging on y-coordinate 1. Ray L2 is hanging on y-coordinate 2, and so on. Okay, so I'm allowing only... And this is, again, not big restriction, because you can always go with the ends, put them where you want. And another thing that occurs as a question, you see the Lagrangians hanging on the rays here, they are not really disjoint inside the manifold M. They look disjoint in E, but in M, it could actually be the same Lagrangian all the time. Okay? So they are not really disjoint. There's no such assumption. Okay, so now we can continue with this. There is a so-called inclusion factor. So what's the inclusion factor? If you take a curve, gamma, in the plane with a curve with a horizontal ends, and not passing through the singularities. So here's an example of a gamma, like this. And here's another one. So if you have such a thing, you can basically use it to go from the Fukaya category of the fiber to the Fukaya category of the of E, and that's.
So I understand, you can only do this with the first kind of gamma, not the second kind of gamma.
Right. Yeah. Okay. I agree. Yes. Good remark. So the ends should be, it should be like the left one. But anyway, you get I gamma, that's a functor from the Fukaya of M to the Fukaya category of E. On objects, it does just the following thing. You take L. I would like to write L times gamma, but I cannot because I'm in a Lefschetz fibration. So I write gamma L like this. What do I mean by this? Well, I'm going, the hook can be very useful also for this. So I am just taking my L here and moving it by parallel transport here and by parallel transport back here. I'm getting a Lagrangian cobordism, okay? The fact that I'm tame, it's tame, makes it easy to define. Okay, so this is trace of L under gamma.
So gamma is some curve which avoids
the critical points. Yeah, the critical values.
Otherwise, it can go where it likes.
Otherwise, you cannot really define it.
But is gamma allowed to cross itself, or it has to be?
No, because you want the thing to be embedded at the end. But sometimes you can make it with crossing.
Oh, but if it wraps around some critical points, you will have monogramming.
No.
So that's still allowed.
Yeah.
So you specifically identify L on the bottom.
Look, that's basically you can go from here, and go here. You start with K and you end up with a Dehn-twist. No, that's allowed and beneficial. Okay, it's a non-trivial fact, but okay, that's an infinity functor. So this is just the description on objects, but it really it respects the infinity structure. And it is well defined up to quasi-isomorphism.
You understand that it's now prone on the map of Hom spaces? Just say for self-Hom spaces, do you understand what the cone on the map of Hom spaces is?
The cone?
I have some L, I look at Hom LL maps to Hom gamma L.
Yeah.
What is the is there an explicit description of that, or is that
no? That's a relatively obvious, right? So, no, that's going to be a cone already. Sorry, that's going to be I'm going to get into this. Yes, that's going to. Well, it depends on gamma. For such a gamma, you're going to get a cone. Yeah. Okay. Very good. So I want to get to the main result somehow, and I'm trying to. So here is a. I'm going to use a set of curves that look like this. So I'm going to take the curve gamma I. So this is y equals 1, and this is y equals I. I index I, not square root minus 1. And that's gamma I. I'm going to use these curves, and I'm going to this will be used a lot, and I'm going to use also some thimbles. So for thimbles, I also need to specify curves. So here's my Lefschetz fibration, and here are the critical points, x1, x2, till xk, critical values, and I'm going to take these curves. So they all end on y equals 1, and the thimbles are going to be called. So each such thing give me a Lagrangian thimble, and I'm going to call them t1, t2, until tk, like this. These are the thimbles. And these thimbles are actually null cobordisms, right? So they are objects of the Fukaya of E. So t1 till tk are objects of the Fukaya of E. Okay, now maybe I can state the result.
Your gamma I's, what relation do they have to the critical point? Do they arrive at the critical point?
The gamma I's are, I'm going to draw them. They are here.
Oh, they're there?
Yeah. Well, they are where you see them.
Yeah, well, I said, what relation do they have to the get? So the
no, they just to the left. To the, yeah, but I have not done anything with them. I'm going to do now.
Oh, I see.
I'm going to do with them something now. Okay, so now I can state the result. So basically, what is the question one would like to know is. So, you have this, the Fukaya category of E, and you have this inclusion functor, how larger, to which extent Fukaya of E is larger than the Fukaya of M? And the surprising answer is that not much larger on the derived level. So theorem, in the derived Fukaya of E, you have the following thing. For every cobordism, null cobordism, you have the following isomorphism. V is isomorphic. And I'm going to write like this, I cone. So this has nothing to do with the Apple company. It's a appleization of mathematics. I stands for iterated cone. And it's I cone. I will explain what I mean by iterated. So you have to take the thimble T1, tensor product with some vector space, E1. T2, tensor product with some vector space, fixed vector space, until you go to TK tensor EK. And now come what Duza asked. The little gammas, you take gamma R LR, gamma R minus 1, LR minus 1. And surprisingly, you don't need L1. So here is the V. That's L1, L2, till LR. And so that's iterated cone. The capital T's are the thimbles, and E1 until EK are just are lambda Novikov vector spaces. Of course, they depend on V, but in a canonical way, depending on V canonically. So by iterated cone, I mean the following. You start from here. You have a map. You take the cone. Then you have another map. You take the cone and continue. So that's an abuse of notation to write like this. But OK.
Excuse me? Yeah? So is I gamma actually faithful?
Yes. Yes.
Sorry, another question. The closed sort of the Lagrangian stuff is a closed Lagrangian semantic non cobordism as well.
Yes. Yeah, definitely. Right. Okay. So what does this really say? That you know, every on the derived level, so how to think of the derived level? If you really want to calculate floor homologies at the end, all you need to know are the ends of the Lagrangian and some vector spaces associated to V only, not to the partner of V in the Floer homology, you know? So, and the thimbles, that's it.
Is this really some sort of, in our view, you have a stronger statement about the T's and the gamma L's being an exceptional collection or whatever, or is that?
It could be that.
The gammas are not a single object.
That's not how you prove this. Yeah.
No. Okay. Now come the following thing. So. Now come. Yes?
Are the vector spaces finite dimensional?
Yes, yes. Finite dimensional, definitely. Now come the following thing. You maybe want to ask the following question. Okay, I have a cobordism. Maybe the cobordism induces some decomposition inside M. After all, at the end of the day, you want to study M, not E, right? So you may think of E as just as an auxiliary, you know, thing, not the main object of study. To get this one. Okay. So it's possible to do. I want to explain that. And now the Dehn-twists will appear. By the way, the same result holds also when you don't have singularities at all. And this goes back to our previous work. But where is the result? Here it is. So if you don't have singularities at all, then all these things, they go away. And you just say that V is an iterated cone over these things. So that's all. Also non-trivial. Okay, so sorry. Okay, so the composition in E, in M. So in M, I'm gonna do the following thing. So I have my U, and my critical values, xk, and I'm gonna fix a base point here, and I'm gonna take these paths, like this. And these paths will induce for me here, in the fiber here, many Lagrangian, vanishing Lagrangian spheres. So vanishing spheres will be S1 until SK, like this. Okay, and I'm gonna use them. And let V in E be a null cobordism. So here's the theorem. In the derived Fukaya of M, you have the following decomposition. So I'm gonna really use that picture. The lowest Lagrangian, L1, is quasi-isomorphic to an iterated cone. And now comes a monster formula. So you should take the Dehn-twist inverse on the last Lagrangian and compose it on the last sphere, compose it with this one. Continue composing until you go to tau S2 inverse on S1 tensor with E1. You attach this thing to. Now you do the same. Now you do tau SK inverse, tau SK minus 1 inverse. But you stop one before, tau S3 inverse on S2, tensor with E2. And you continue like this until you get to tau SK inverse on SK minus 1. Then you go to just, I forgot, tensor. Ek minus 1. Now you have sk tensor ek. And now you have the more civilized part, which is lr minus 1 until l2. That's it. OK, so yeah, it's a long formula, but what can you do?
When you write this, do you know the names of the maps, or you just say no or
something? I know, but not. I think you would not be satisfied with the answer. I mean, they have to do with a cobordism somehow. And but OK, this is what happens, right? So you have to take the Lagrangians that appeared here, attach them one to the other, take successive cones, and then take the vanishing spheres and continue attaching them, tensored with some vector spaces. That's the result. So in particular, when you don't have any singularities, the result says that the Lagrangian, the L2, the L1 here, is an iterated cone over the rest. Those. This is what you get. Right. Okay. So I think I have how much time?
5 minutes.
5 minutes. So there are two choices. Either I go and give an incomprehensible proof due to the 4 minutes, the 5 minutes time I have, or I want to motivate why do I actually care about this? So there are many answers. Not all of them are always convincing. One answer is that what?
You didn't get to vote if you wanted your motivation or your incomprehensible.
Yeah. No, let's not vote about that. So, of course, you could say the following thing, that you see, you have the derived Fukaya category, which is a kind of a notoriously algebraic thing. So you take Lagrangian submanifolds and then add to them all sorts of extremely algebraic objects like mapping cones, and so on. And then in the end, you get something that algebraically behaves better, but you added some very weird objects there, right? What is the relation between these objects and geometry, or even topology? So this approach tells you actually that many, many times the cones that you get are actually induced by something geometric. So if you want to get cones, interesting cones, you maybe can produce interesting cobordisms. This will give you cones. The cones will give you exact sequences, and this will induce the algebra. But I want to give so that's one motivation to study.
A question about the motivation. Yeah. So you're saying that this tells you that a lot of the cones you have actually have the same geometric interpretation.
Yeah.
But I mean,
or even generate them.
What you're saying is that a very special type of cone has a geometric interpretation. Couldn't there be all kinds of much more cones?
So the question is, you are asking now, to which extent the modules, right, that you get via cobordisms give you the whole set of space, the whole category of modules. How large are the abstract modules than the ones coming from here? In a way, that's a little bit open. We don't know. I wouldn't expect that all modules will come from that, not even in the triangulated envelope. But at the same time, we are now playing with some approach that takes also into account immersed Lagrangians and immersed cobordisms, and there the answer seems to be yes, you get everything. And if this works, this will give a complete geometrization of the Fukaya, derived Fukaya. But okay, we are not there yet. So, but I want to give a much more some other motivation to study, coming from real algebraic geometry. So I'll be brief here, but I want to explain the principle. So one thing that when you look at real algebraic manifolds, one of the things that you see is that if you take a complex manifold, it sometimes happens that it can be endowed with completely different real structures, right? So the kind of most famous example that everybody knows, let me call it M. Well, you can take, say, M equals CP1 cos CP1. And here are two different real structures. One of them, the first anti-holomorphic involution, will just send Z0, Z1, comma, W0, W1. It will send it to, say, Z0 bar, Z1 bar, comma, W0 bar, W1 bar. And the real part of C1 It's just, in this case, it's an RP1 cross RP1. So it's a T2. But you have another real structure here, which is the following, C2 on Z0, Z1, W0, W1. That's just you switch the coordinates and then conjugate. W0 bar, W1 bar, Z0 bar, Z1 bar. And the real locus is Lagrangian sphere. It's an S2. Okay, and kind of the question is, okay, so you can have many real structures. What is the relation between them? Now, in general, I don't know how to answer such questions. It's too general. But under some situations, and I can a little bit explain how, you can actually claim that different real structures are cobordant, Lagrangian cobordant, inside the Lefschetz fibration. Okay, so here it how it goes. So if X inside CP N, large N, is a projective. Now I don't know how to call it. It's a projective real complex manifold. So it's a complex manifold endowed with a real structure. So real complex manifold. Then you know you can take hyperplane sections of it, and you can parameterize the space of hyperplane sections by a dual CPN. So you look at the dual CPN, and each point here is a hyperplane, and you can cut X with this hyperplane. So here is your X, and you can cut it with a hyperplane here. Sorry, that's CPN, that's X. And if here you have a point here, you can look at X intersecting with H lambda. That's H lambda. And you get your M lambda. That's a hyperplane section here. OK? Now, if you are not lucky and this H lambda hits X non-transversely, you're going to get a singular manifold. And that's actually how you create Lefschetz fibrations. So here inside, you have the discriminant locus, or the dual variety, X star. And basically what happens is that the complement of this here is of complex codimension at least one, and therefore the complement is connected. This means that all these M lambdas, they are by Moser argument, symplectomorphic. They are not biholomorphic, of course, but they are symplectomorphic. However, if you now look at the real loci, then things dramatically change. So if X is embedded in a real way, you can consider real hyperplane sections. So hyperplane sections that are invariant under the involution of X.
So you're assuming when you say embedded in the real way that the involution extends to CPN? Is that what
you're saying? No, yeah, I mean that, yeah, other way around. You take this one and it restricts here.
Restricts,
yeah. Okay. Restricts there and keeps X invariant. So I mean X bar equals X. So there's an intrinsic way to describe these things, but you can take a real ample line bundle, things like that. But that's equivalent, basically. So, okay, so just to finish the story, so you can now look at the discriminant locus of real things, and this is inside RPN. Or better written, CPN dual real part, like this. Now this is disconnected. So here you have this RPN, And inside it, you get many chambers, many, many chambers of real structures. And this is exactly what happens here. So if you take, so here is, for example, the real structure that gives you RP1 cos RP1, and here is the one that gives you S2. And now, exactly what happens exactly that if you, you see, when you look at hyperplane sections, and you take a pencil, a so-called pencil, inside the dual CPN that hits the dual variety transversely, you get a Lefschetz pencil. You need to blow up the base locus, then you get a Lefschetz fibration. And if you take the pencil to be real, you're going to get precisely a Lefschetz fibration, and inside it, a Lagrangian cobordism with, not null cobordism, but that's not a problem, with one end starting here and the other end here. So you're going to get really a fibration, sorry, a cobordism that whose projection is going to look like an interval. It's going to pass through the singularities that are real. So some of the singularities are real, some of them are, you know, conjugate points. So each time you hit a wall, you go through a singularity. And here you have the real part corresponding to this. Here you have the real part corresponding to this. And if you want to go to be in the null cobordism, then you can always bend and go like this. So really these cobordisms, they appear from real structures. I cannot say any results yet, but what the hope is that using these decompositions, you could say something about the relation between the topology of different ends.
What are these x's you brought on this curve?
X's?
On this curve.
These are stars. These are the critical values.
But I mean, so the thing about that is there's some sort of singular Lagrangian.
No, this is smooth Lagrangian, this is smooth. And
when you go in there,
the thing is smooth. The whole thing is smooth.
Ah,
the fibers are singular or possible?
Yes. It's a smooth cobordism. I mean, that's almost, not totally obvious, but it's not hard to prove. Just because, you see, you get actually a Lefschetz fibration, and inside it you get a real Lefschetz fibration. And it becomes smooth automatically.
Are you taking the real locus of the fiber about this
thing? Yeah, yeah. Yes, yes, yes. So, of course, you pass through singularities. Right. Okay, so that's how these things occur naturally. Okay, I think I should stop.
All right, do you have any questions for our speakers?
So does this thing have anything to do with this Acampo method for computing intersection matrices of real polynomials considered as complex polynomials in two variables? There you can draw like the vanishing cycles in the real part.
To my shame, I don't know about his method. So, and therefore, I don't know if there's a relation. But
Do you expect to get a lot of Lagrangians from this?
A lot of what?
A lot of Lagrangians in like as the kind of fixed parts of this involutions in these chambers.
No, of course there are huge restrictions on what Lagrangians you can get. That's I'm sure. I think not everything is will appear as a real part. I mean, there are also classical topological restrictions on such things and so on. But what is kind of, I think, more interesting is, you see, when you start talking such pictures, what you get many times is that the real locus is actually disconnected. Even on Del Pezzo surfaces, real ones, you get the real locus can be, you know, four copies of a sphere plus other components. And then you get a cobordism, which is very special, right? So the Lagrangian here is really a disjoint union of Lagrangians. And maybe you can kind of find restrictions of this type. I don't know.
So if you take a complex legal and its flag variety, like different real structures, can you find cobordisms between those?
I don't know. Ways? I don't know. I would definitely try.
I mean, this has to do with
some
complicated paper about, you know,
the construction model representation. Joe, do you ever think about the net, the just from the system perspective? You know, the Nash conjecture about whether every manifold is a real part of it. In fact, Kohler proved some form of it. It was surprising to me that it wasn't all, but loads of three manifolds were a real part of just rational varieties, rational things. Have you thought in the symplectic world, is it completely not still for something like this? Or, like, is there some obvious obstruction to being the real part of that?
Yeah, well, obvious not, but there is one result which is kind of known. But it, in fact, it has nothing to do with real. It has to affect only to with being Lagrangian. And so this goes back to Viterbo. So Viterbo looked at real Fano manifolds of dimension, real dimension 6 or more, showing that the real part can never be hyperbolic. But then later, it's your result with Eliasberg, and so Eliasberg, Giventhal-Hofer, extended it to all Lagrangians in such things. So the fact that somehow in Viterbo's proof, the fact that it's real played a role, and in their proof, it didn't. So, but yeah, this is what I mean. That's a serious restriction, and I'm not aware of many others that are not topological. They don't come from topology, you know.
So what are you saying, since I didn't know this result at all, that if you have a Lagrangian, a closed Lagrangian submanifold in some kind of monotone symplectic manifold, that it can't be hyperbolic?
It's in your book.
Is it? Well, I don't know. Which?
I think so. I'm not sure. Yeah. So if you have a Fano manifold.
So that's you're talking about a complex manifold.
Complex. Yeah. What's important there really it is that it's uniruled.
Oh,
this is how the proof works.
Okay.
But Fano and any closed Lagrangian submanifold there inside it cannot be hyperbolic.
So if it was symplectically uniruled, that would also
would be fine. Yes.
Right.
Yeah, but I forgot if it's enough uniruled or you need uniruled with something about the Chern class, but I have to look it up. That is satisfied in the Fano case.
Okay, so who proved this
theorem? Eliasberg. Giventhal and Hofer. Eliasberg, Giventhal and Hofer. The proof is basically the following. You take these spheres, the holomorphic spheres, you look at the little neighborhood of the Lagrangian, you stretch the neck, you do the SFT game, you stretch the neck, and then you get some kind of SFT building there, right? So you're gonna get, so in the cotangent bundle of the Lagrangian, that's where you stretch the thing, then you're gonna get geodesics, right? Now, if the thing is hyperbolic, if it would have had a hyperbolic metric, then you could calculate the index of this thing and get a contradiction to the index that you come from the Fano story. Right? The proof works something like that, I think. That's the idea. And Viterbo did something quite different with symplectic homology, I think.
All right, so I think we should stop and let's thank our speaker now.